Welcome to Science Store online classes.
Don't forget to like our video and subscribe our YouTube channel for all the updates.
Well, students, let's solve some more problems under this Coulomb's law. Two particles, each of mass m. There are two particles, both are having a mass m and carrying charges q. The charge of those two particles is q and mass of those particles are m. Both are having same mass and same charge, are separated by some distance, If they are in equilibrium under mutual gravitational and electrostatic force, there are two particles, students. They are having same mass, same charge, and they are also under equilibrium. What equilibrium? See, if two particles are kept here and released, they will fall down due to gravitational force. But if those two particles are balanced by electrostatic force as well as gravitational force, they will be under equilibrium state. They will not accelerate downward, right? Such a case. So they are under equilibrium with the gravitational and electrostatic force. Then what is q by m? Q is charge of them and m is mass in coulomb per kg, that is the SI unit, is of the order 10 to the power of minus 5, 10 to the power of minus 10. They are just asking the order, they are not asking the value. Means something into 10 to the power of this values would come. So how to do it? When they say, when a question mentions that if they are in equilibrium under mutual gravitational and electrostatic force, then you should understand that the gravitational force acting on those two bodies or particle should be equal to the electrostatic force acting on those two bodies. I tell you, Q1 and I'm sorry, there are two charges, charge A and B. I can't take Q1 and Q2, A and B. Okay, they are separated by some distance r. They did not mention, I will take it R. What is the charge of A? Q. What is the charge of B? Q. What is the mass of A? M. What is the mass of B? M. Now, what is the electrostatic force acting between, acting on A and B? The electrostatic force between them is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, right, into q into q, that is q square divided by r square. So let me consider this as a k because that is a constant value. Okay, this is the electrostatic force acting between them. What is the gravitational force acting between them? We know that any two bodies with the mass, they will exert gravitational force between them. So g times of mass of A into mass of B, m into m, that is m square divided by distance separation square, that is r square. So since they are under equilibrium, remember, since they are under equilibrium, Fe is equal to Fg, then k times of q square by r square is equal to g times of m square by r square, gets cancelled. We want q by m, so q square by m square is equal to g divided by k. Q by m is nothing but square root of g divided by k. Then q by m, we just want the order, student, we don't need the value. So what is g value? What is g value? G value is 6.67 into 10 to the power of minus 11, correct? You should remember that value. Okay, divided by k value, you know what is the k value? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 power of 9. So now forget about this parts as we don't want the value. So this can be written as 6.67 divided by 9 into 10 to the power. When it goes up, it will become minus. So minus 11 into 10 to the power of minus 9 is nothing but 10 to the power of minus 20. So this part I don't resolve. I just square root of 10 to the power of minus 20 is approximately 10 to the power of minus 10. So Q by M is the order of 10 to the power of minus 10. Option B is the right answer. We just need the order, whatever the value this may give. Question number 5. Two spherical conductors B and C. There are two spherical conductors. One is B, another one is C. Equal radii, their radius is same, and equal charge. Let me call the charge of B as a Q and C as a Q. They have equal charge and equal radius. Repel each other with the force F. What is the force between them? Let's say R is the distance separation. Then force between them is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught or K. You can consider it as a K, whatever. Okay. K into Q square divided by R square. Do you agree with that? Because Q into Q is Q. A third spherical conductor, A, having the same radius but uncharged. Third spherical conductor, but it is uncharged but same radius, is brought contact with the B. Okay, there is A. Now there is A, which is not charged. Let's say these are positively charged. This is also positively charged, right? Okay. And it brought in contact with B. Am I correct? A third spherical conductor, A, having same radii but uncharged, is brought in contact with B. B is positively charged. What happens when a conductor brought in contact with the charged conductor? It will attain charge. B already have Q. What charge? So after this, what will be the charge of A? A will attain charge Q by 2 and B will attain charge Q by 2. Am I correct? Two conductors brought contact. One is charged, another one is uncharged. So that afterwards A and B will get equal charge. Both will get equal positive charge. That is Q by 2. And what happens then? Brought in contact with C. Now A is already charged. What is the charge of A? Q by 2 plus. Okay. Q by 2 is the charge of A. That brought in contact with C. C also has same radius. But charge of C, initial charge of C is how much? Q. Now they are in contact. Again, conduction takes place. They should have equal charge. What is the charge of A now? And what is the charge of B? What is that equal charge they should have? Equal charge they should have is Q by 2 plus Q divided by 2. Am I correct? Here Q plus 0 divided by 2. So Q by 2 is the charge of each body. Here Q by 2 plus Q. Total charge divided by 2 is nothing but the charge on each body. That is how much? 3Q by 4. Correct? So A and C will attain positive charge. So the charge on A and C will be 3Q divided by 4. I hope you are following what I am saying. First, there were B and C. Both are charged Q and both are having radius A. So the force between them is this much. Now an uncharged conductor A brought in contact with B. B has Q charge, A has zero charge. After conduction, A and B will attain Q by 2 of charge. Now, that A is brought in contact with C. A has Q by 2 charge, C has Q charge. C had Q charge, right? So, due to conduction, both will attain. So, total charge plus half, equal charge they should attain. So, the total charge plus half is total charge is Q by 2 plus Q. By 2 is nothing but 3q by 4. Now charge on A is, this is final charge on A, this is final charge on C, this is final charge on B. These are the charges on A, B and C, right? Now what the next part of the question says, brought in contact and finally removed away from both. The new force of repulsion between B and C. Now, they are removed away. Again, B is here, C is here, separated by same distance. But the charge of B is different, right? What is the charge of B? Q by 2. What is the charge of C? 3Q by 4. Now, they are asking what is the force between them. So, force between them is nothing but K times of, what is the charge between them? Q by 2 into Q by 4 divided by R square. So, K into Q square divided by 8 R square. So, K into Q square by R square is nothing but F. K into Q square by R square is nothing but F. So, this is F dash, right? F dash is the second force. So, can you say that F dash is F divided by 8, because K into Q square by R square is F. So, remaining is 1 by 8. Option C is the right answer. Option C is the right answer. I hope you are following this. So, this is the force when B and C are equally charged. Then B and C are separately brought in contact with A, and again B and C are separated by a same distance. Now the force between them is F dash, which is equal to this much, which can be written as the initial force divided by 8. F divided by 8. Isn't it a good question? Right? So, yes. F by 8 is the new force of repulsion between B and sphere B and sphere C. So, here you should know the Coulomb's law, you should know conduction of charges, when the charges conduct, right? I don't know whether I have mentioned or not. During conduction, when one charged body and one uncharged body brought in contact, the uncharged body will attain the charge. Charge will be equally distributed. If you bring two charged body, right, charge will be equally distributed between them. Remember that always. During conduction, charge will be equally distributed between the two conductors which are brought in contact. Yes, we will solve some more problems under Coulomb's law. We'll move to the next problem. Two identical spheres carrying charges minus 9 coulomb and 5 micro coulomb, minus 9 micro coulomb and 5 micro coulomb. One is positively charged sphere and another one is negatively charged sphere, right? Okay, this is minus 9 micro coulomb, this sphere is 5 micro coulomb. Identical sphere means their radius should be equal, okay? Respectively are kept in contact, then separated. They kept in contact. So, this is minus means, minus 9 coulomb, micro coulomb means there are 9 extra electrons. Here, there are 5 extra protons, okay? From each other, they kept in contact with each other and then separated. Point out true statement from the following. If you look at the statement, something electrons are in deficiency, some electrons are in excess deficiency. So that means they are giving the number of electrons, whether it is excess or deficiency, you should know. See, when this, if I name it as A and B, when A and B are brought in contact, so the conduction will take place. What is the charge after conduction? We know that total charge divided by 2, correct? So charge after conduction is minus 9 microcoulomb plus 5 microcoulomb divided by 2, minus 4 microcoulomb by 2. So minus 2 microcoulomb is the charge on A and B. After conduction, the both A and B, right, they will have minus 2 microcoulomb. Now we know the total charge. So since it is minus, obviously we know that electrons from A will transfer to B. So now from the formula, Q is equal to N into E plus or minus N into E. N is equal to plus or minus Q divided by E. Which I should consider, plus or minus? I should consider minus because it is an electron transferring. Electron is transferred from A to B here, or conduction takes place. During conduction, electron is exchanged between A and B. So what is the total charge? Minus 2 microcoulomb divided by what is the charge of the electron? Minus 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. So microcoulomb can be written as into 10 to the power of minus 6. So what will be the answer? 2 divided by 1.6, that's 1 divided by 0.8 into 10 to the power of plus 13, if I am not wrong. 1 divided by 0.8, how can you write it as 1 by 8? So 1 divided by 0.8, what will be the answer? 1.25, correct? Yes, 1.25 into 10 to the power of 13. So 1.25 into 10 to the power of 13 electrons are in excess. Why it is excess? If it is deficiency, then Q should have been plus. We have excess electrons, so we got Q as minus. So that matters here. So Q, if Q you get here is plus, then the answer would have been A. But here Q is minus, so answer is B. Hope you got this point. Next, moving to the next question. Force between two identical charges placed at a distance R in vacuum is F. We know, right, what happens when two identical charges are placed at a distance. They will experience electrostatic force. What is the force experienced by those identical charges? So let's say 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. If Q is the charge of each identical charges, then Q square divided by R square. Correct? There are two charges, Q and Q. They separated by distance R. Then 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R square is the force between them in a vacuum. Now, a slab of dielectric constant K is equal to 4 is inserted between them. The thickness of that slab is R by 2. The force between the charge will now become, so when you place the dielectric between them, the force would change, correct? So now, in between those two charges, Q and Q, you place a dielectric medium. What is the dielectric constant of it? 4. K is equal to 4. What is the thickness? R by 2. Means, if R is the distance between them, R by 2 is the half of the distance. Thickness is half of the initial distance between them. So now what is force? F dash is equal to how much? So just assume that when you place the dielectric medium, right, the distance separation we will change so that the force experienced by those two charges when there was no dielectric medium should be equal to the force experienced by the same two charges when you place the dielectric medium. I repeat, now we will consider a scenario in such a way that, see, those two charges when they were in a vacuum, this was the force. Now I place a dielectric medium and I vary the distance separation between them. It's not just r now, it will become r dash. Now the total distance separation, right, that is r dash, in such a way that after placing this dielectric medium, the force experienced by these two charges should be equal to force experienced by the same two charges in a vacuum. What I am trying to say is F dash is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into k q square divided by r dash square. What is r dash? R dash is the recent or the new distance separation between those two charges. I have changed the distance separation. I repeat, so two charges were there. There are two charges. So here is one charge, another charge is here. The distance between them is r. Okay? Now they are in a free space. And force between them is this much, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q by r square, assuming that q is the charge of these two. Now what I do is, here in this gap, I place a dielectric medium of thickness r by 2. R was the initial distance, thickness r by 2. And I vary this distance. I vary these two distance in such a way that even now, force between these two charges should be equal to this force. So, F should be equal to F dash. F should be equal to F dash. So, if F is equal to F dash, then K times of R dash should be is equal to R. Do you agree with that? So if you compare both the expression 1 by 4 epsilon, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, q square, here you have r square, here you have k into r dash square. So k into r dash square is equal to r square. Am I correct? So now can you say that k r dash is equal to r? So if r is k r dash, so yes, this is how the expression should be, not just okay. K r dash is r, then what will be r dash? R dash should be r divided, this is not the expression. It was correct. K r dash square is equal to r square, then r dash should be equal to r divided by k. Am I correct? No confusion. Okay, this is what the expression, no confusion, r dash square, then k r dash square, here we have k r dash square, here we have r square, so r dash will be r by k by 2, means whatever the distance separation we have in the second case when we place the dielectric medium, right, so that is the 1 by k terms, 1 by root k terms of initial distance separation. I repeat, r dash is 1 by root k times of initial distance separation. Correct? So this is clear now. This is clear now. Now, what is the force between them? I have mentioned about a formula. The force, the r dash according to the formula I have mentioned while discussing synopsis, r dash is r minus thickness of the dielectric slab plus thickness times of square root of dielectric constant. We remember this. So now substitute that formula and find out what the force you are going to get. So the force now, F dash is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q square divided by r dash square. So here you have k. r dash square is nothing but r minus thickness is r by 2 plus thickness r by 2 into root 4. K is 4. Am I correct? Yes. So we don't have to mention k according to the previous formula. Now 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q square divided by r minus r by 2 is r by 2, okay, plus r by 2 into 2. 2 gets cancelled. So what can I write it as? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q square divided by, if you take the LCM, that is two r plus two r, so this comes here 2 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q square divided by 3 r. Whole square is there, right? Whole square. Yeah. 3r whole square. Then, yeah, this also whole square. 3r by 2 whole square. Next problem, a force between two identical charge placed at a distance r in vacuum is force. There are two identical charge, means charge of two particles should be same. I erase small portion of this so that I can use it for a calculation purpose. Okay, there are two charges, fine. So the charges are A and B. A and B are charges. What is the magnitude of charge in them? Q. They are identical charge, means they should have an equal amount of charge. And what is the separation between them? R is the separation between them in air. R is the separation between them in air. Now, what is the force experienced by them? Force experienced by them is F, which is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught according to Coulomb's law. Charge into charge, that is q square divided by r square. So this is force experienced by them in air. Okay, force between two identical charges placed at a distance r in vacuum is F. Now slab of dielectric constant k is equal to 4 is inserted between the two charges and thickness of the slab is r by 2. The force between the charge will now become, so now what you did is, what are you doing is, so in between these two charges, in between the charge A and B, you will place a slab of dielectric constant 4. In between A and B, you will place a slab of dielectric constant 4. What is the thickness of that dielectric material? That is R by 2. Just thickness of this is r by 2. And now what is the force? F dash is equal to how much? That's what they are asking. So obviously when you place a dielectric medium, force would vary. So how to tackle this? How to solve this? So we know the formula. I have discussed about that formula, correct? So formula, F dash is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q 1 into q 2 divided by q 1 into q 2 divided by r minus thickness plus thickness times of root k whole square. Correct? Okay. Now, what is thickness? Thickness is r by 2. And yeah, we know the remaining parts. So we shall solve this. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q square, because q1 and q2 both are q, divided by r is the initial distance separation, minus what is the thickness of the slab, r by 2, plus what is the thickness of the slab, r by 2, into root, what is the k value, 4 whole square. So 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, I just write it as k, students, just to avoid lot of numbers on the board. Okay, k into q square, r minus r by 2 is r by 2, plus this root 4 is root 2, so gets cancelled, root 4 is 2, so gets cancelled, so r whole square, which can be written as k into q square divided by, if I take the LCM, 2 is the LCM, and r plus 2r, that is 3r whole square. Am I correct? This is the new force. Now, new force is equal to this, see, k into q by r square, so 2 by 3 whole square, correct? 3 by 2, when it's the reciprocal of that is 2 by 3. So I take it as square 4 by 9 into k, I write it first, into k into q by r square. Now substitute the k value, 4 by 9, k value is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, and q by r square. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, q not q, it's q square, I just missed it. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, q square by r square is force in air. So can I say that F dash is equal to 4 times of, this is F in air, correct? 4 times of force in air divided by 9. So do I have that answer? 4F by 9? Yes. Correct? So this formula we have discussed. This formula, r minus thickness, r is the initial distance separation between the two charges, plus thickness times of root k. This formula we have discussed, which is nothing but r dash. What is r dash? Oh, now the question is, what is r dash? See, r dash is such an arrangement in the setup. So when two charges are separated by r, this is the force. When you place the dielectric constant, that force will change. Now what I do is, I place the dielectric constant, I change the distance separation between two charges A and B in such a way that force between two charges without the presence of dielectric medium should be equal to force between two charges in the presence of dielectric medium. That is your r dash. I repeat, force without the presence of dielectric medium is F. So that should be is equal to F dash in such a way that, so F should be is equal to F dash. If F should be is equal to F dash, then the R should vary. That varied R is R dash. That is this much. So what is that value? If they ask you what is that value, you should calculate that. So yeah, this is about the problems which comes under Coulomb's law. In the next class, we'll discuss about electric field and problems which comes under electric field. So we are discussing about electrostatics, and we have discussed about charges and Coulomb's law. Today we will discuss about electric field, and we'll solve some of the problems related to that. So what is electric field? Let's refresh what we have learnt in a board class. Electric field means it is the surrounding around a charge. Wherever the charge has its effect, right? Charged particle has its effect, right? that is called as electric field, correct? Or else you can also say that space around a charge is called as electric field, or the space in which charged particle has its effect is called as electric field. Okay, so when you place a unit charge, you know what is unit charge or what is test charge? It is a unit positive charge, correct? When you place a test charge in the vicinity of any other charge, or else if you place a test charge in the electric field of any charge, that test charge will experience the force. What I am saying is, I have a charge here, Q is the charge. So this charge will have its effect in the surrounding. So that surrounding is called as electric field. The surrounding in which this charge has the effect is called as electric field. And when I place a test charge, in the electric field of any other charge, this test charge will experience the force, that is electrostatic force. So that electrostatic force experienced by the unit positive charge or the test charge is called as electric field intensity, and it is denoted like this. This is the representation of electric field intensity. It is the force experienced by the test charge or unit positive charge in the electric field, right? So what happens? This test charge will experience the force. If this Q is positive, as this test charge is also positive, test charge will experience repelling force. Means this test charge will move along this direction. It will get repelled by this charge. If this is negative, since it is test charge and positive, it will be attracted by this. So the direction of force experienced by the test charge in any electric field is nothing but the direction of electric field intensity at that point. When I place this test charge here, that will experience the attractive force along this direction. So this is also the direction of electric field intensity at this point. So at every point or wherever you place the test charge, the direction of force experienced by the test charge in the electric field is nothing but the direction of electric field or electric field intensity at that point. So let's say this is a positive charge. Let me call it as a source charge, because this charge is the reason for the electric field in this space. So this source charge is somewhere here, and I place a test charge here, which is at a distance d from the source charge. Okay, my test charge is at a distance d from the source charge. Then the electric field intensity experienced by this test charge is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q, that is the source charge, divided by square of the distance. I repeat, electric field intensity at any point is nothing but the electric force experienced by, or electrostatic force experienced by, the test charge in the electric field. So since it is the electric force experienced by the test charge, electric field intensity will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by d square. So as I told you, electric field intensity is the force experienced by test charge. What is the magnitude of the test charge? 1, right? So if it is not a test charge, so force per charge is nothing but electric field intensity. So you can say that electric field intensity is nothing but electrostatic force per charge or per unit charge. So from this you can also say that electric force, electrostatic force experienced by any charge is equal to electric field intensity at that point times of the charge which experiences the electric force. I repeat, let's say Q is the charge which experiences the electric force, then the electric force experienced by the charge Q in any place is nothing but E times of Q, where E is the electric field intensity at the point where Q is placed. Okay, so electric force, electrostatic force is nothing but electric field intensity times of the charge which experiences that electrostatic force. And Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, the direction of electric field intensity will be along the direction of the force experienced by the charge. Now, suppose this is not air medium. This is the dielectric medium with the dielectric constant K. Then electrostatic force experienced by this test charge in the electric field of capital Q is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into K Q divided by D square. I repeat, if the medium is not an air medium, it is a medium with a dielectric constant K, then electric intensity is nothing but electric intensity at this point is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught K into Q divided by R square. This is the electric field intensity at this point if this is an air medium or a free space. If this is any other medium with the dielectric constant K, then this is the electric field intensity at the point where plus Q, small letter plus Q is placed, the small test charge is placed. So if you compare equation 1 and equation 2, you can say that electric, this is in the medium, right? This is in air. So electric field intensity in any medium with dielectric constant K is nothing but electric field intensity in air divided by the dielectric constant of that medium. Electric field intensity in any medium is nothing but electric field intensity in air medium divided by, or free space divided by, dielectric constant of the medium. So now electric field intensity or electric field is also a derived quantity. The dimensional formula of electric field is, this is the dimensional formula of electric field or electric field intensity. What is the SI unit of electric field? From this you can say that SI unit of force is Newton, SI unit of charge is Coulomb. So Newton per Coulomb, electric field intensity SI unit is Newton per Coulomb. Newton per Coulomb is the SI unit of electric field intensity. So the electric force is independent of mass and velocity of the charged particle. It depends upon the charge, correct? We have seen it in a previous class. Electric force is independent of mass of the charge. It is only dependent on the charge of the particle. And if you want to know what is the total electric field at a particular place, because if you have many charges, you have one more charge here, this is Q1, this is Q2, this is Q3, then at this point, if I call this point as a A, at point electric field is nothing but electric field due to charge Q1 plus electric field due to charge Q2 plus electric field due to charge Q3. What I'm trying to tell you here is electric field at any point is nothing but the algebraic sum of electric field due to all the charges. So here we have three charges, Q1, Q2 and Q3. So electric field intensity at A due to Q1 is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q1 divided by D square. Let's call it as D1 square. Then electric field intensity due to Q2, let's take this distance as D2. Then 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q2 divided by D2 square plus electric field at A due to Q3. Let me call this distance as D3. Then 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q3 divided by D3 whole square. This is the total electric field intensity at A. So now how can I write this as electric field intensity is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is common, Q1 divided by D1 square plus Q2 divided by D2 square plus Q3 divided by D3 square. So this is the net electric field. So how can you say this? Electric field intensity at any point is nothing but algebraic sum of the electric field intensity at that point. Now, if you have a two positive charges, let's say you have plus Q here and another plus Q here. Plus Q and plus Q, okay? Then, what is the null point? So, let's say this is the distance separation between them. D is the distance separation between them. So, what is the null point? Null point means electric field should be zero. So, where electric field is zero? Where do you get electric field is zero? You will get somewhere here. Let's say x is the point where you are getting electric field is zero. Then that x distance will be is equal to, x distance will be is equal to d divided by square root of okay, let me take it as q1 and q2. Okay, q1 and q2, there are two charges, q1 and q2. So d divided by, it can be positive or negative, anything it can be. So q2 divided by q1 plus or minus 1, square root of q2 by q1 plus or minus 1. I repeat, there are two charges, students. One is q1, it can be plus q1 or minus q1. Another one is q2, it can be plus q2 or minus q2. The distance separation between them is d. They are separated by a distance d. Okay, I want to know where the null point is. What do you mean by null point? Null means zero, correct? So electric field is zero. When I say null point, I mean to say that electric field intensity is zero. So there are two charges still at a particular place or particular point, electric field will be zero. Which is that point? So that point is measured with this formula. So the null point is equal to the total distance separation between them divided by square root of ratio of the charges plus or minus 1. Where do you use plus and where do you use minus? So this will be plus. If these two charges are like charges, this will be minus. If these two charges are unlike charges, what do you mean by that? If Q1 and Q2 are plus, Q1 is also plus, Q2 is also plus. Or if Q1 and Q2 both are minus, then this is Q2 by Q1 plus 1. If Q1 is plus, Q2 is minus, or Q2 is plus, Q1 is minus, then this here it should be minus. So the formula here will be, formula for this will be x is equal to d divided by square root of Q2 by Q1 minus 1. The formula here will be x divided by, I'll write it here, x is equal to d divided by square root of Q2 by Q1 plus 1. If both the charges are plus or if both the charges are minus, then here it will be plus. This is the formula. If one is plus, another one is minus, any one of them, if they are unlike charge, then this is the formula to find the null point. Now tell me, what if both the charges are with the same magnitude? Both are Q. Here one is Q1 and another one is Q2, right? What if both are Q? If both are Q, the null point will be at the center. Okay? If both are Q, the null point will be at the center. Okay. Yes, well students, so now we will apply it to different cases. So we'll apply this formula to different cases. Now I have two charges which are equal in magnitude. Okay, both are positive or both are negative. So I have two charges which are equal in magnitude. So plus Q and another one is also plus q. The distance separation between them is d. Then null point is at the center. Okay, what will be your x? X is the point where do you get electric field is equal to 0, that will be d by 2. Null point is at the center. The intensity of electric field at the midpoint of line joining of charges will be 0. Now, there are two charges, plus q and minus q. What is the charge, what is the electric field at the midpoint? Okay, there is one. So this is one application. Second one is, there is one plus q and there is one minus q. They are separated by the distance d. Plus q and minus q are separated by the distance d. Now what is the electric field at the center? Electric field at the center will be for these two charges, plus q and minus q, equal and opposite charges, will be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught 8 into q divided by d square. 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught 8 q divided by d square. This is when two equal and opposite charges are there, the electric intensity at the center. When you have two equal and like charges, the electric intensity at the midpoint will be 0. Here electric intensity will be 0. X is equal to d by 2. X means the position where the null point is. Okay, next, third point. You have two equal charges. Okay, you have two equal charges plus q, which are placed on two vertices of equilateral triangle. Two vertices of equilateral triangle. So let me consider an equilateral triangle. Okay, the side of this triangle BA. A is the sides of this triangle. Okay, there are two charges. One is here plus q, another one is here plus q. Two equal and like charges are placed. What is the electric field intensity here? What is the electric field intensity? Electric field intensity on the other third vertex is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by d square into root 3. Root 3 times of 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by a square. The sides are taken as a, right? So a square. If you have a two like charges which are placed on a two ends of the or two vertices of an equilateral triangle, then the third vertice, intensity of electric field at the third vertex is this much, root 3 times of 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Next, if these are unlike charges, you have a equilateral triangle, okay, sides are A, and here you have a plus Q charge and here you have a minus Q charge. What is the intensity here? Electric field intensity is equal to how much? So electric field intensity here is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by d square. Intensity on the third vertex is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by d square. What is the difference between these two? Both are equilateral triangle, both are having the side A, but here you have like charges, here you have unlike charges. Now you have an equilateral triangle. Sides are A, and you have three charges, students. Three equal charges, plus Q here. Here also you have plus Q, and here also you have plus Q. Now, what is the electric field intensity at the centroid? At the center, what do you have the electric field intensity? So electric field intensity at the center is 0. At the centroid you have electric field intensity which is equal to 0. Okay, this is about three equilateral triangle. Now what is the force experienced by a charge which is placed in an electric field intensity E? Force experienced by charge Q in an electric field intensity E is nothing but EQ. Correct? Force experienced by the charge Q in electric field intensity E is E into Q. So now that we know E, we know electric force experienced by the charge, can you tell me what is the acceleration of it? You bring a charge to the electric field, it will experience the force, so it will start to move. When it is moving, it will accelerate. So acceleration of the charge Q in any electric field intensity E is nothing but, see, acceleration is F divided by M. Correct? M. F is equal to M into A from second law of motion. Acceleration is equal to F divided by M. Acceleration of the charge in any electric field is nothing but F. F is nothing but EQ. Am I right? So F is EQ divided by M. M is the mass of the charged particle. So acceleration of charged particle will be EQ divided by M. EQ represents its force or a force experienced by the charge Q, and M represents its mass. If this is the acceleration, then the velocity of the charged particle after time t, let's say it starts from rest, a charged particle attains velocity after time t. Initially charged particle is at rest, the velocity attained by it after time t. So from using kinematic equation, u plus at, u is 0 because particle is at rest. Initially particle is at rest, so what you can write it as, V is equal to A is EQ by M into T. So this is the velocity of the charged particle which starts moving from rest. Okay, which starts moving from rest. So as you know velocity, what is the distance traveled? Distance traveled by charged particle, we will use x formula here. X is equal to ut plus half at square, right? What is ut? 0, because initial velocity is 0. Half at square, half. What is a? This much. Eq by m into t square. So distance, displacement is nothing but half into EQ by M into T square. So this is the displacement or distance traveled by the particle. So now your charged particle, let's say it is in an equilibrium state, or it is okay, there is one charged particle, okay, here it remains suspended. The mass of the charged particle is m, so it is suspended in an electric field E. This is the electric field, and m is the mass of charged particle, some any charged particle, charged body. It is suspended in an electric field. There is a uniform electric field, a charged particle is suspended. Then, see, now the force acting due to the gravity of the earth will be is equal to force due to this electric field. What happens when you place a there is one electric field here. A charge Q is placed in an electric field. What happens? This charge will start to accelerate. This charge will start to accelerate depending upon which charge is this. So if it is positive charge, it will start to move along this direction. The charge will start to accelerate. Okay. The charge is kept here. There is no electric field, but there is a gravitational force. Charge will fall down due to gravity. So that means charge will accelerate downward. This is a charge. I drop the charge here, it will fall down. Because it will experience gravitational force, so it will accelerate in a downward direction. So if gravitational force and electric force are acting individually, the charge will accelerate. Am I correct? So here, when it is placed in an electric field, it will experience electric force, so it will accelerate along this direction. When the charge is dropped or it is kept in a gravitational force, it will accelerate downward due to gravitational force. But in my condition, or but in this scenario, a charge is suspended in an electric field. Means there is one electric field here and a charge is suspended in the electric field. So what are the forces acting on that charge? One is gravitational force, another one is electric force. But as this charge is not accelerating, acceleration of this charge is zero, the gravitational force and the electric force acting on this charge should be equal. Am I correct? The magnitude should be equal. So in this condition, whenever a charge is suspended in a electric field, the gravitational force acting on that charge, that is m into g. M is mass, g is acceleration due to gravity. So mass times of acceleration is force. So gravitational force acting on that charge should be is equal to the electrostatic force acting on that charge. So gravitational force is m into g. What is the electrostatic force acting on any charge? That is E into Q. If Q is the charge of this particle, then E into Q is nothing but M into G. If you want to write it in a vector form, M into G vector is equal to electric field into Q. So, whenever a charge is suspended in an electric field, the gravitational force Mg is equal to electric force, that is E into Q. Remember this, we will be solving so many problems under this concept. Okay, and then so you have a hollow sphere. Okay, you have a hollow sphere, radius is R. Then what is the intensity of electric field at any point inside the hollow sphere? You have a hollow sphere, this is hollow sphere, so charge will be always on the surface of the sphere. Okay, Q is the charge of this, total charge. Let's say radius of this hollow sphere is R. Then at any point inside this hollow sphere, electric field is zero. So at any point on the surface of this hollow sphere, electric field intensity is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square. At any point somewhere here, which is at a distance x from the center, here electric field is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by x square. I hope you are following. If you have a hollow sphere, the radius of the sphere is R, then the electric field at any point inside the hollow sphere, electric field intensity is 0. On the surface of the hollow sphere, it will be always 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q by R square, where R represents radius of the sphere, and at any point which is at a distance x from the center will be 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square. So intensity of electric field inside a charged hollow conducting sphere is always 0. Okay. Now you have a Bob, metal Bob, which is positively charged. Let me quickly say that. You have a metal Bob which is positively charged and it is kept in an electric field. Let's say electric field is acting upward. This is the direction of electric field, which is upward. Okay? You have a metal Bob which is positively charged and it is oscillating. This is how the metal Bob is oscillating. You should imagine the simple pendulum here. How simple pendulum oscillates? It oscillates in a semicircle way. Correct? So let's say that Bob is positively charged and you keep that whole setup in an electric field where the electric field is acting upward. Then the time period of that Bob will be is equal to, what is the time period of simple pendulum, students? Time period is 2 pi square root of L divided by G for this normal simple pendulum. Here, time period of that pendulum or the Bob, if the length of that pendulum is L, G minus EQ by M. EQ by M. If this electric field is downward, then time period of that pendulum will become 2 pi square root of L divided by G plus EQ by M. Remember this concept, okay? If a pendulum is positive, I'm sorry, it is not downward. It can be downward or it can be negative. If it is positively charged and it is oscillated in an electric field where electric field is acting upward, this is the time period. If it is negatively charged, then the time period will be this. So this is about your electric field and electric field intensity. We'll solve some of the problems related to that.
Don't forget to like our video and subscribe our YouTube channel for all the updates.